Hi, I am Dr. Sridhar Kalyanasundaram, consultant neonatologist. Welcome to my channel. Thank you for subscribing, keeping notifications on, and sharing with your colleagues. I hope you would continue to do the same. In the next few videos, I will be discussing on some special aspects of breastfeeding and in relation to this composition and the various aspects of breastfeeding. And I hope this will be useful to you as well. As I referred to in the previous video, I request you to look at the playlists. The playlists for parents and the playlist for the medics are separated, and for the parents as well, there are individual playlists which might be of use to you at different situations. So do look into it and share it as you find appropriate. So in this video, we look at the evolution of breastfeeding. So this is not a medical discussion. It's more about evolution. How life evolved in the world and how breastfeeding came about as part of that process. Breast milk is nature's gift and it's unique to mammals. The mammary gland, which is a medical term for the breast, is designed to provide complete nutrition to the offspring soon after birth. When scientists began to trace the evolution of breastfeeding, it dates back to hundreds of millions of years ago when the first animals walked on land. Once a life started existing on dry land from water, before the reptiles, birds and mammals evolved fully as they are now, we had vertebrates, vertebrates with amniotic membrane around the embryos, the classification as amniotes. So they started existing, and dinosaurs are examples for that. They could have begun secreting water from simple glands in their skin. Their eggs were porous and would dry and perish on the land. The water from these glands would have passed on to the eggs through the pores to keep them moist and safe. So this is basically an evolution to protect the eggs which were laid on land instead of water, and that allowed them to survive. In terms of evolution, the secretion that we see from frogs and then worms to nourish their eggs and young worms relate to this as well. So you can see that here the mother worm is having a nutritious edible layer of skin which the baby worms can feed on. Similarly, we have seen birds feeding the chicks from their mouth, not only the food that they bring from outside, but if they run out of food, they can shed from their holocrine secretions, the glands which are present in the upper part of their neck in the mouth. They can break the secretions, the whole gland breaks and the secretions can be fed by the baby birds. So this is a part type of feeding of the babies. So we have the marsupials, which are the early stage of the mammals, where the development of the embryo happens outside in a sac. And the platypus, for example, has eggs, and these are able to breastfeed. So these are mammals, but they lay eggs. The kangaroo, for example, the baby develops in the pouch. They are born into the pouch very tiny. Most of the development happens outside, and the pouch expands as the baby grows. The kangaroo has multiple glands which secrete milk-like secretions which the baby can feed on. The Swedish biologist Linnaeus categorized species into groups, and he called the host of mammals, including humans that lactate or produce breast milk, as mammalia. So mammals means of the breast. The females of these species, as we understand now, nourish their young with milk from their mammary glands. And as the mammals evolved, so they got litter of animals, a few piglets and puppies at the same time. So there is competition between them, multiple nipples. So the shape of the breast is different. And the cow, for example, has one or two calves like the humans, and the same with camels. So the number of babies reduces, the nature of the breast evolves. And the human breast, obviously, you have two breasts and one nipple on each side. So that's again process of the physical evolution. So the mammary gland originated via adaptation of the apocrine sweat glands. So if you look at the mammary glands, they're actually modified sweat glands with several similarities. They have secretion by exocytosis and budding. There is association with myoepithelial cells which allow them to contract and release, and hair follicles are associated as well. The mammary glands, however, have many specialized adaptations. They have the ability to undergo repeated bouts of proliferation secretion, as happens with pregnancy, followed by involution when the baby stops breastfeeding. There is also a greater variety of secretions and more complex hormonal control. The breast anatomy evolved from pores on the skin, which I mentioned in the initial stages, to specialized glands with specific anatomy. This anatomy of having the areola and nipples has two main advantages. One is the areola and the surrounding ducts store the milk, so it's ready for the baby to feed. and having this anatomical orientation and pointing into a nipple to shed the milk makes it safer. There are risk of infection from the milk on the surface of the skin getting bacterial colonization and then infection passing on to the mother and the baby is much reduced. When the baby breastfeeds, the breast automatically gets cleaned once the feeding is finished. And this is the shape of the breast anatomy. So the ducts store the milk and these all lead to the nipple area. The baby actually sucks on the areola as well as the breast. So when we give the breastfeeding, we should make sure the baby is biting on the whole areolar area, not just on the nipple. Otherwise, it will cause sore nipples, as we will discuss later. So the genetic basis is also interesting, that the genes for casein, which is the milk protein, are ancient and they developed even before lactation evolved. And as the lactation evolved, the nutrition supporting capability of the egg. So for example, in birds and reptiles, the egg has vitellogenin genes, which produce a lot of supply, lot of nourishment, while in human eggs and the need for supply is reduced as the placenta supplies and then the breastfeeding. So these genes get switched off in mammals. And several components of the milk fat, lobule membrane and alpha-lactalbumin, which have immune origins, are also preserved over generations. The composition of the milk also evolves with the species evolution. Lactation obviously allows the mother to feed her offspring relatively independently of the source of her own food, and she relies on her stores of energy, macro and micronutrients. The presence of antimicrobial factors in the milk is proposed to have emerged from what we mentioned to protect the local infection, but as we evolve, we produce more protective factors, human milk oligosaccharides and so on, to reduce the risk of infection in the species. After the mammals evolved as a group and went down different evolutionary paths, milk continued to change, and these changes reflect the unique needs, the speed of growth and maturation, how long the species tends to support their baby with breast milk and so on, and how the baby can feed themselves. So it's different lengths of feeding, different composition. For example, the cow's milk and the camel milk have much higher amounts of protein and fat compared to human milk, and that's why in the first year of life these milks are not suitable. The load on the kidneys and the digestive system is much higher, and there is a higher risk of gut bleeding due to the high protein intake, so you may become anemic as well. So lactation also serves as a signaling tool between the mother and the baby, and this is important. Getting the resolution of conflicts in the signaling is important in terms of getting the feeding pattern right, settling the colic phase and so on. So encouraging the mother to learn is very important. The feeding pattern, non-primates like dogs, for example, feed instinctively. There is less of learned behavior. There is survival of the fittest context between the siblings fighting with each other because there are many babies. The mother, however, has a protective instinct which is balanced to all the siblings, so this protects them to some extent. So there is less learned behavior, more of instinctive behavior. In primates, there is less instinctive behavior and more of learned behavior, and human beings are obviously advanced, and this is even more prominent in us. Breastfeeding is a natural process, but it's not instinctive. So we need to teach them, we need to have a learned behavior. Because we don't see many relatives breastfeeding anymore, the natural process is lost, the cultural part is lost as well. So we need to support the mothers antenatally, start early, think about breastfeeding, don't assume it will work naturally, think about how to support the mother and take it on. Obviously, breastfeeding is best, and any level of support that goes will be very useful for the future generations. So to conclude, it's very interesting to look at this evolutionary aspect, which we don't normally look at, and it's a dynamic process. There is constant change, as we will look at in the future presentations, on the composition being dynamic as well. We should consider it one of the best gifts of nature and do our best to support exclusive breastfeeding. So I hope it's useful. Thank you for watching, and do turn on notifications and do share.